Yellow Pilgrim. That's right. Peter addressed Bible believers, saying, "Dearly beloved, I beseech you as strangers and pilgrims." And Bible believers can hear the Bible taught every Saturday at high noon and Sunday at 9:30 p.m. right here on 91.5 Freedom FM. Pilgrim.
Welcome to Bible Believers Fellowship and the conclusion of our study of Mark chapter 10, verses 1 through 9, where Jesus defines marriage. Our website is kjvbiblebelievers.com, where all of our messages are made available for free in MP3 downloads or in streaming video. And if you like what you hear, we encourage you to tell others about this free online resource at kjvbiblebelievers.com. As we conclude this study, we look at what marriage is and what it is supposed to be a picture of, and that is something very important and dear to the genuine Bible believer, and that is the bride, the body of Christ, and the bridegroom, Jesus Christ. And that is why the so-called gay marriage atrocity is so disgusting. So when a person destroys a marriage, it is an attack on the God-ordained picture that he intended the world to see. So now we turn to the conclusion of our study of Mark chapter 10, verses 1 through 9, titled, Jesus Defines Marriage. Now look what it says, though. He says, but. He's now going to say, now that's the revelation that you've received up to this point, that you're allowed to divorce, God allowed it, but. Read verses 6 and 7. Read it with me. But from the beginning of creation of God... I'm sorry, let's start again because the preacher just messed it up. But from the beginning of the creation, God made them male and female. For this cause shall a man leave his father and mother and cleave to his wife. Now look at that closely. From the beginning, God intended one man and one woman to come together, leave their father and mother. That's been a problem with a lot of marriages. Kids don't grow up and they won't put some separation between them and their parents. And cleave to his wife. So that nullifies gay marriage. It's to be a man and a woman. That's what I'm saying. This nullifies that. Jesus just defined marriage as one man and one woman. But they don't care what Jesus thinks. See, when you're talking to people who try to redefine marriage as a man and a man or a woman and a woman, you're talking to somebody who doesn't care what Jesus says or thinks. They can call themselves Christian till they're blue in the face. They are antichrist. You say, what? Hey, anything opposed to Christ is antichrist. And when you teach gay marriage, you are antichrist. Rob Portman is antichrist. Let's be bipartisan here. Barack Obama is antichrist. Let's go all across the board. I don't care who you are. If you say, now I was going to say like Rick Warren, but he kind of flip-flops according to who he's talking to. Sometimes Rick Warren's antichrist. Yeah. So you're talking about what the Bible says. One man and one woman versus the world right now. Whose side are you going to choose? And what if it costs you something? What if it costs you family members? What if they'll no longer invite you over for green beer on Sunday? Amen. What if they won't invite you out for the Christmas thing this coming December? What if your friends, unfriend you on Facebook. What if they no longer read your tweets on Twitter? What will you do? That's the price that we're going to have to be just honest about being willing to pay. We're going to lose associations. And some of you are working in jobs. I don't know where all of you work, but some of you, may work in jobs where if they find out you take that stand, they may not fire you and say it's because you stand against gay marriage, but they'll find something. They'll find something. So you take a man and a woman, and they are to cleave. And this is the major point that Jesus is getting at. And that is defined in the 1828 edition of Webster's American Dictionary. I recommend that. 1828 edition. That was before all the political correctness. Hey, political correctness started way before the 60s. You go back to the Darwinian era, and they were already starting political correctness. And then John Dewey and his politically correct public school system that's been in control in this country since the early 20th century. This was before that. And the word cleave is given a couple of different definitions I want to zero in on. One is to stick, to adhere to hold to. When you get married, you're to be stuck to one another. You adhere to one another. It's like concrete. Number three definition given by Webster is to unite or be united closely in interest or affection, to adhere with strong attachment. And these down at the bottom are Bible verses. I didn't add that. That was in that dictionary. If you go back to the founding of this country and read the founding writings, you'll find them chock full of scripture all the time. You want to find out what they taught before John Dewey raped our schools of the Word of God? Go get some McGuffey readers.
Right.
And you'll see they were chock full of scripture. They learned the ABCs, and every letter represented something from scripture.
That's right.
So when you go down to Jackson, you see a picture of Jesus on the wall of the school, and the American Civil Liberties Union, which ought to be called the Antichrist Lawyers Union, goes down there to take that picture off that school wall. They are not only Antichrist, they're anti-American. They're anti-constitution. We're supposed to have freedom of religion.
Yes.
And they're not to prohibit the free exercise thereof. That's the First Amendment. But they're doing it. But you go back there and you see he references Genesis 2, Matthew 19, and Joshua 23. And he compares, look, marriage to your relationship to God. Cleave to Jehovah your God. Just like you cleave to your husband or wife. Very interesting. And this is understanding that helps you understand what he means in verse 8. Read verse 8 with me. And they twain shall be one flesh. So then they are no more twain, but one flesh. Man, woman, cleave. And they now are supposed to be like that, just the way when you come to God believing the gospel. That's the way it's supposed to be. And I want every young person in the room to listen to me right now, and I want this clear. You have sex outside of marriage. That's what this is representing. When legally, in this state, and biblically, you are married, not when the preacher says, say I do, I now pronounce you. That's religious tradition. Doesn't really have anything to do with anything. We do it because we understand that you're going to proceed with the consummation of that marriage with sex. Did you know that? Some of you might have never heard that because the churches don't teach nothing anymore. That's on the law books. Go read it. If you get in front of me, and I've done my share of marriages, but I want to tell you, every couple I marry, I explain this to. You get in front of me, and I say, I now pronounce you. I don't say, I now pronounce you man and wife. I say, I now announce that you are man and wife. Because I don't have the power to pronounce anything. You say, well, the state gives you that power. Well, the state isn't where my power resides. I only preach and teach the power I'm given the Word of God. And what I announce is that you are now man and wife with the understanding that we have talked and you are going to consummate that marriage sexually. And if you then have sex outside of marriage, it's not when you're caught and you go through divorce court that you've divorced your spouse. It's when you have sex outside of marriage that in the eyes of God, you've already divorced. Now, if you start to get that, that'll clear up a whole lot of nonsense you're taught about divorce and remarriage in this country. And it includes what they teach about preachers. There's a bunch of preachers who've only been married once, and they attack preachers who have gone through divorce and remarriage like I have. And their basis is that they teach that marriage is a ceremony because they've had many wives. Maybe some of them before they even got saved, some after they got saved. I know a lot of guys who did it while they're in Bible college. Why do I tell you that? Because everybody needs to wake up. You're dealing with human beings, and you need to deal honestly with the Scripture. Throw out the fiction. And when you come together, man and woman, come together, you become one flesh, and sex is the consummation of that. And it pictures the one flesh. If you don't understand that, you don't even know what he's talking about when he says you're one flesh. But that's what he means. And that then remains unless you go off to another partner. And when you do that, you have destroyed that. Amen. Amen. And that's what the one, when it says cleave, it's talking not just in some ceremonial sense, it's talking even in the flesh, one flesh. That's what the sex act is. It's cleaving. That is why then Jesus says in verse 9, read it with me, "What therefore God hath joined together, let not man put asunder." And that's not talking about the local judge. That's talking about you and your spouse staying faithful to one another for life. And if you cheat on your spouse, you are the one who's going to answer for putting that asunder. Now, we also don't want to forget the whole picture. That if you have done these things, there is forgiveness. But that doesn't mean he removes all the consequences. As I said before, if you cheat, you destroy your marriage, you're going to have all kinds of consequences of that. There will be forgiveness if you turn and confess your sins. He's faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us of all unrighteousness. The blood of Jesus is that powerful, but what he doesn't remove is the consequences. If you've cheated and you got some sexually transmitted disease, you not only ended up divorced, but you ended up with something that you will then have to worry about, because if you marry again, you'll pass it on to them. And if it's deadly, you could kill your spouse. There's forgiveness, but there's still repercussions. And on that plays out as you consider it. But this is the thing that Jesus is pointing to, is God's will. God desires for marriage to be a lifetime commitment between one man and one woman. That's how Jesus defines marriage. And in our next study, we'll see that God allows for divorce. But this is always a contradiction of his design for marriage. And we'll get more into that one more time. But this is the big picture. That when you come together like this, you are picturing Jesus and his bride, the church. That's why it's so important that if you get married, and by the way, Paul said he would rather you not. I just want to put that on the table. All the single people are saying, amen. I would rather you just go ahead and stay single. That way you stay out of all this nonsense and all this, you know, and then you can focus on serving the Lord and all that. But some desire companionship, and if you have, and God gives you that desire, and you are then met up with a believer, because it says be not unequally yoked, but if you meet up with a believer and the two of you decide to get married, there's nothing wrong with that. But if you do it, you ought to go into it understanding how serious this is. And you are picturing Jesus and his bride, the church. And Jesus, thankfully, doesn't divorce. You don't have to worry about Jesus cheating on you. You don't have to worry about Jesus divorcing you. And that's why Ephesians 5, 25 and 26. I want you to turn there. This is where we're going to close. But I want you to read this in closing. Ephesians chapter 5, beginning in verse 25. And even if you're single, even if you're a young'un, this is important to get the picture. Ephesians chapter 5, beginning in verse 25. Read that with me. Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it, that he might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of water by the word. Look at that. Husbands ought to love your wives just like Jesus loved the church and died for the church. They always say this, what's every woman want? She wants a man who would die for her. God put that desire in your heart because you are the bride, and the bride has a Savior, the groom, the bridegroom, who died for the church. The bride, that's the question. Are you a part of the bride of Christ? That's the question today. You can't really understand the whole marriage thing. You can't understand all this we're talking about unless you are born again by faith in the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Jesus paid the full price for your sin. He shed his blood as payment for that sin. People say, why did he have to shed his blood? Why couldn't he just die? Because he took that blood and he went up to the temple in heaven and he sprinkled it on the mercy seat as full payment for the sins of the world. And he was buried and he rose again. Why? Because he proved he is the resurrection and the life. He proved he has the power to raise himself. And if he can raise himself, he'll raise you. Amen. And that is what you then trust in. You believe that, trusting in what Jesus has done for eternal salvation. And then this weird thing, to me it was very strange to get grasp of this, you're now part of the bride. Yep. Male or female, there's neither male nor female. You are now part of the bride. And when God calls you out of here at the rapture, he's calling his bride. Just like in the Jewish wedding, when the bridegroom, without setting a date, didn't send out invitations, he just would one day, when he was ready, march down to the bride and he would call out, come up hither! And that's what we're going to hear one of these days. Amen? Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it. So as we close, we're going to partake of communion. And I'm going to ask Brother Mike
near the cross, O Lord. hell.
It's like it's part of
them. Boy, makes you glad you're saved. Amen?
Amen.
Four of you are. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. All right. Let's
be sure to visit our website at kjvbiblebelievers.com, where you can find a wealth of MP3 audio message downloads, along with additional videos, articles, and links. This message is brought to you by Bible Believers Fellowship, P.O. Box 662, Worthington, Ohio, 43085. I am Greg Miller. Thank you for listening.
Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth.
Visit the online ministry of Bible teacher and elder of Bible Believers Fellowship in Worthington, Ohio, Michael Kaler. Visit 2 Timothy 2-15.org. That's 2 Timothy 2-15.org.
Bible Believers Fellowship presents a verse-by-verse study of the book of Revelation, available free to view on streaming video or download in MP3 audio by simply visiting kjvbiblebelievers.com. Download these free expository studies of the book of Revelation and share them with others by putting them on flash drives, burning CDs or DVDs, or simply post links to our messages in email or on your own Facebook or other social media site. Just visit kjvbiblebelievers.com, look under Videos in the menu to the right of the page, and click on the Book of Revelation link, where you will find hours of free Bible studies and streaming video, and eventually, you will be able to access our study of the entire Book of Revelation. If you prefer MP3 audio, click on the MP3 audio page link at the very top of our webpage, and use the search to pull up our Book of Revelation studies. All are provided free of charge, thanks to the free will offerings and support of the Bible Believers Fellowship family and kjvbiblebelievers.com.
It is a documented fact. New versions of the Bible are Vatican versions. You will not be told this by most ministries, even though it is a fact. You will not be told this in most Bible colleges and seminaries, even though it is true. New versions are Vatican versions, and you can see the proof laid out in a free 2-hour documentary available to watch in streaming video at kjvbiblebelievers.com, where you will find a link in the right column menu. Just go to kjvbiblebelievers.com and click on New Versions or Vatican Versions. Don't buy the lies. Get the truth and get back to the King James Bible. New Versions or Vatican Versions is also available on DVD for a gift of $10 to cover costs. You can pay by PayPal at kjvbiblebelievers.com. Simply add a note requesting your DVD copy of New Versions or Vatican Versions, or send a check or money order to P.O. Box 662, Worthington, Ohio, 43085. New Versions are Vatican Versions, and you should be informed. Watch the documentary at kjvbiblebelievers.com and get back to the King James Bible today.